Well, Pastor Joel has taught us over the last few weeks, the book of Hebrews was written to Jewish believers who were in danger of leaving this place of trusting in Jesus alone for their salvation and going back to a works-based Judaism. And in this passage, the writer of Hebrews is exhorting them to stay the course. Don't waver in their faithfulness to Jesus. And over the last few weeks, the writer of Hebrews has been making a point that Jesus is greater. It's on those invites. You see it on the screen as well. Jesus is greater. And Pastor Joel taught us that Jesus is greater than the angels. Jesus is greater than the prophets. And today we're going to see that Jesus is greater than Moses. Now, there's nothing wrong with Moses. There's nothing wrong with the angels. And there's nothing wrong with the prophets. But the writer of Hebrews is proving a point that Jesus is greater. He's above them all. Now, along with the comparisons that the writer of Hebrews has made, he's also mixed in five warnings in the book of Hebrews throughout the whole book. Previously, Pastor Joel taught on don't drift, and Steve mentioned you can pick up a copy of that CD in the foyer. But today, the writer of Hebrews, after talking about Moses, he delivers the second warning. And that second warning is, don't disobey. Instead, be faithful to Jesus. And he's exhorting these Jewish believers here to stay the course with Jesus, not to let the persecution stop them from following fully of Jesus, because Jesus is greater. And he starts in verse 1 with the words, therefore. And whenever you see that word, therefore, you need to go back to find out what it's there for. That's why we read verse 18 of chapter 2. It's the connector. It says this, for in that he himself, Jesus, has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. So Jesus is able to aid those who are being tempted. Jesus understands how we operate. He understands how we're made. He understands us because he was like us. And Pastor Joel taught us last week that he lowered himself and he became like us. And because of that, Jesus gets it. He knows. Jesus knows. He understands. He understands the pressures that you face. He understands the stress that you carry week from week. He understands the worry that eats at you. He understands the power of temptation that plagues you. He understands the physical tiredness that you feel. He knows what it's like to be hungry and angry or hangry. He understands what it's like to be annoyed, etc. Jesus gets it. Therefore, because Jesus knows all these things, the writer of Hebrews is talking to the readers. He's exhorting these readers to be faithful to Jesus because Jesus gets it. And the word faithful implies an unswerving adherence to a person, thing, or an oath or promise that you make. Now, I love to teach Sunday school. I've had the privilege of teaching, I think, every class here from nursery up to grade 5 to 6 in kids' church. And in every classroom, I like to teach them how to be faithful because it's built right into every classroom that you get to teach these kids how to be faithful. Now, you can't do this with younger kids. They have to be older. They have to be able to go to the bathroom on their own and where it's okay to go. But in every single classroom, it's inevitable that a kid will say, I have to go pee. And some kids, they wait till the last possible moment, till they're doing the, you know, I gotta go, Pastor Dan. And you're like, okay, well, that's fine, go ahead. But some kids, they don't really have to go pee. You're boring as a teacher, and they just want to leave the classroom. I know this. I know you guys do this. My class is in here today. No, it's not you. But this is a great opportunity to teach kids what it means to be faithful. Because you tell them, okay, here's what you're going to do. You can't talk to an usher. You go right to the bathroom. You can't get a drink of water. You come right back. Will you be faithful with that task? And the kids have the opportunity. They can say, yes, I will be faithful. Or, no, I don't think I can do that. I have to get a drink of water too. Okay, well, just get a drink of water and come back. So I tell the kids that faithfulness means that you'll do what you say you do. So I tell the kids, well, you can go to the bathroom if you're faithful. If you promise me that you're going to be faithful, they say, yes, I'm going to do it. And so they promise me, so they go off and do it. And some kids, they come running back, and they're like, guess what, I was faithful, I did it. And you give them high fives, and it's all exciting. But some kids, you have to go after them. And you find them leaning up with an usher and like, so how was your weekend? Yeah, was it good? Everything's good? Yeah, do you have a coffee this week? Whatever. But it's like, no, what are you doing? Go back to class. You weren't faithful. See, sometimes these kids don't succeed at being faithful. And you have to go find them and tell them, and they come back. But faithfulness is doing what you're supposed to be doing. You can be trusted to do what you say you're going to do. You stay the course. You do what you signed up for. That's faithfulness. And the point of today's passage is be faithful. The author of Hebrews is exhorting Christians to remain faithful to Jesus, to persevere, to push through, to keep going, keep trusting in God, keep reading your Bible, keep going to church, keep applying the Bible to your life. So let's look at verse 1. It says, "Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus." Well, first of all, the author uses the words holy brethren and partaker of this heavenly calling. And he's reminding these Jewish believers and us who we really are. You are holy. Chapter 2, verse 11 talks about Jesus being our captain and bringing many sons to glory, and that he's not ashamed to call us brethren or brothers and sisters. And because Jesus is committed to bringing many sons to glory, you are a partaker in that. You get to join in and partner with Jesus in that heavenly calling. And our holy high priest, he's not ashamed to call you holy brethren or brothers and sisters. This, to me, it doesn't make sense, because you should see my thoughts sometimes. They definitely aren't holy. But yet this is who Jesus says I am. I feel like a screw-up sometimes and unworthy of God's blessings. But this is who we are. This is how God sees you because of Jesus Christ. You're holy and you're a partaker with Christ in this heavenly calling. And then the writer, he encourages us to consider or think about Jesus and dwell on Jesus. And he uses the words apostle and high priest. Now, we don't often think of Jesus as an apostle, but the word apostle means sent one, or ambassador, or messenger. And of course, Jesus is an apostle because he was sent by the Father to provide the gift of salvation to mankind. So Jesus is really the ultimate apostle, or sent one. And then the title high priest, Jesus is the one who represents us before the Father and who represents the Father to us. This is the job of the priest, and we're going to dig into that when we get to chapter 5. But because of these things, we're to consider Jesus, or remember Jesus as we move forward on this path of life. He's our motivation. We fix our thoughts on Jesus with great attention. We are to act as he would want us to act. We're to live as he would want us to live. Why? Because Jesus is the ultimate ambassador. He's our high priest. And because of, as chapter 2 ended, we see that he is able to aid those who are tempted and struggling in this life. Jesus is able. He knows. He gets it. So Jesus is able, so we look to him. Jesus suffered. He experienced similar things in his life that you go through. So we look to him because he gets it. He understands, and he can help. Therefore, Jesus is who we're supposed to remain faithful to. Verse 2 says, "Who was faithful to him, who appointed him, as Moses also was faithful in all his house." This is saying that Jesus was faithful to the things of God that God appointed to him, just like Moses was faithful. And the author uses Moses to illustrate to this point to the Jews, because Moses was highly revered to them. He brought the Israelites out of Egypt. He brought the law. And some of the Jewish Christians at the time wanted to go back to this because of the persecution they were facing for being a Christian. And the author is going to show us that Moses was faithful, but Jesus, he showed perfect faithfulness. Verse 3 and 4. "For this one has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who built the house has more honor than the house. For every house is built by someone, but he who built all things is God." So because of the position of Jesus, he's been counted worthy of more glory than Moses. Jesus is the Son of God. Therefore, Jesus is the one that should be magnified and glorified, not Moses. And it says God built everything. The builder gets more honor than the house. Famous architects, they get recognized for the buildings they design and create. The buildings are wonderful to look at and admire, but the recognition goes to the builder or the architect. And the author is saying that God built everything, so he should get the recognition. Jesus is God. He built the house. Therefore, Jesus is greater than Moses. Well, verse 5 says, "And Moses indeed was faithful in all his house," that's God's house, "as a servant, for a testimony of those things which would be spoken afterward." So Moses was faithful to all that God asked him to do in God's house, and he did a great work. And that work serves as a testimony or an illustration of the truths of God, and it would point to the work of Jesus Christ. But Moses was simply a servant in the house of God, just like you and I. Commentary says, "Despite Moses' great faithfulness in following God's redemptive plan in the Exodus and recording the law, Jesus is superior. The house analogy shows that Jesus, as the Son of God, who was also actively involved in creation, has a privileged place in the household of God, while Moses remains a servant in that household. Therefore, Jesus is greater than Moses. Well, verse 6 says, but Christ as a son over his own house, whose house we are if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm to the end. What this is saying is that Jesus is the son over his own house, and we're a part of that house if we hold fast and stay firm to the end. Now, on first read, it kind of sounds like works-based theology. I have to start strong, I have to persevere till the end, and then I'm a part of the house. Then I get to go to heaven. That's not what that means. What this verse means is that if you stay the course, that gives evidence that you are saved. If you press on and you continue on in the things of God, this gives evidence of your salvation. This shows that you are a truly committed follower of Jesus Christ. You see, true commitment to Jesus is demonstrated over the long term, not just at salvation. At salvation, there may have been an emotional response or maybe a logical, well-thought-out decision. In either case, you realized the weight of your sin and your inability to deal with it yourself, and you trusted in Jesus to forgive you of your sins. And the writer of Hebrews is saying, remain committed. Stay faithful to Jesus. Don't lose that. He's encouraging them to stay the course because there's those who feel like turning back or turning away, and maybe you're here today. And he's encouraging them to hold fast. Stay the course to the things of God. It will be worth it. The persecution they're facing back then will feel light in compared to the glory that's going to be revealed in heaven when you get there. There's something bigger going on here, so remain faithful to Jesus. Now, I really enjoyed reading Matthew Henry when studying for this message. And he said this, in a word, they must walk closely, consistently, courageously, and constantly in the faith and practice of the gospel, that their master, when he comes, may approve them. This is how we are to live, Christians. You made a choice to accept Christ as your Savior, and this affects the rest of your life. That should change how you live. We should walk closely, consistently, courageously, and constantly with Jesus. See, to be faithful means you carry out what God requires of you. It goes beyond the flashy, fun things of life, and it goes deep down inside of your character. Will you be faithful when no one's looking? Will you follow God when no one sees? Will you follow him when it's not popular to follow him? Or when it makes you look bad, will you follow him? Will you apply God's word to your life and be a doer of that word? See, faithful is not a very exciting way to live. It's perseverance, it's loyalty, and it's resolve. But it's worth it. It's the best way to live. And that will be fully realized when you get to heaven. See, this first section, it's encouraging us to be faithful and to look to Jesus. Now, the second section that we're going to look at, this is the warning. Don't disobey. Instead, be faithful to Jesus. And the author is going to be taking us through Psalm 95. And this psalm is God's response to Israel's tragic choice. Let's take a look at it. Verse 7. It says, therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, in the day of trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tested me and saw my works 40 years. Therefore I was angry with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. In verse 7, it tells us the Holy Spirit is the author of the Bible. I know that David wrote Psalm 95, but the Holy Spirit provides the inspiration for the Psalms, just like every other book in the Bible. And I love that it says today. Today, if you will hear his voice. Or in other words, listen up. Tomorrow's too late. So listen today and act. Do something about it. And in verse 8, he warns us not to harden our hearts like the Israelites did before they entered the promised land. And you can read about it in Numbers chapter 14. The Israelites didn't want to take the promised land because of unbelief. They didn't trust God. And they feared the people that were in the land, and they complained about it. Numbers 14, verse 1 and 2 say, they wept all night long, and they complained against Moses and Aaron, saying, if only we had died in Egypt, or if only we had died in the wilderness, wishing they were dead when they were on the edge of the promised land. After this report of these spies that said, the land's amazing, but still, there had to be a step of faith to trust God to go after the land. And God's response in Numbers 14, verse 11 says, how long will these people reject me? How long will they not believe me with all the signs which I have performed among them? And God goes on in Numbers 14 and verse 28 and 29. He says this, as I live, says the Lord, just as you have spoken in my hearing, so I will do to you. the carcasses of you who have complained against me shall fall in this wilderness, all of you who are numbered according to your entire number from 20 years old and above, except Caleb and Joshua. Those are the ones who believed God. They trusted him. See, God's serious about unbelief. God did so much. He performed so many miracles to the children of Israel, and yet they still did not believe God. Their hearts are hard towards him. And the writer of Hebrews is using this picture to warn us. Do not harden your hearts. He's saying, don't be like these guys. Don't do as they did. They failed. And their simple failure was they didn't believe God. They didn't trust him. And now it's interesting. Who does this passage say hardens hearts? You do. You harden your own heart. Others don't harden your heart. Circumstances don't do it. You harden your own heart toward the things of God. We often say our hearts have been hardened by others or circumstances, but the fact is that we harden our own hearts in response to what may be done to us. You harden your heart to the things of God because circumstances maybe were wrong or didn't go the way you wanted. But notice what God says to the Israelites, wilderness experience, in verse 8. He calls it their day of trial. Other translations say time of testing. God wanted the Israelites to step out in faith and trust God to take the promised land. And the Israelites needed to do so as God directed them. So it's a time of testing or trial for the Israelites. Will they remain faithful to God? Well, some of you might be in a time of trial yourself or a time of testing. Something just isn't working out the way you want it to. You don't understand why things are difficult right now. You don't see any logical reasons around it, and it just doesn't seem to make sense. Life is difficult. If you're in that time, you have a choice. You can harden your heart to the things of God, like the Israelites did, or you can remain soft to God. And you can involve him in the trial, in the testing. And you can take steps of faith and watch him work in the midst of it, just like God did with the Israelites. And I can tell you from experience that it's way better to stay soft to the things of God. Because when you are, you're more open to him working on your heart. See, when I'm soft to the things of God, I look to the word with expectation. I pray with expectation. I believe that God can do it. I believe God will do it because he is God and I am not. But when your heart is hard to the things of God, you aren't looking to the word with expectation. You aren't praying with expectation. You're simply bitter. You're grumpy where you think, God hasn't done anything for me. I'm in this mess and he's not doing anything about it. Why should I go to church? Why should I read my Bible? Why should I pray? It's not going to change anything. Yes, it will. It will soften your heart to the things of God. See, hardening your heart is like a spring for all other sins. Once your heart hardens to the things of God, it's more easier to run to sin. And we're going to talk about that more as we move on. But in verse 9, it talks about the evidence the Israelites had seen, and yet they continued to test God with their unbelief. The Israelites that left Egypt with Moses, they really have no excuse. They saw some pretty amazing things. Crossing the Red Sea, manna from heaven, water from a rock, yet they still test God. And verse 10 tells us what a hard heart toward God does. It makes him angry. It says, therefore I was angry with that generation and said they always go astray in their heart and have not known my ways. God is angry with them because they saw all his work, but it didn't change them. They chose to go after something else. And the word anger here, it does not refer to an emotional outburst or disposition. Rather, it refers to a divine reaction to evil and the following judgment upon that evil. And there's consequences when God gets angry. Take a look at it. Verse 11. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. We read about the consequences in Numbers 14. The complainers will not enter the promised land. They die in the wilderness. And they did die in the wilderness. They stayed there for 40 years while all of the complainers died. See, God's very serious about unbelief. He's very serious about a hardened heart. And the writer of Hebrews is reminding us, and these Jewish believers he's writing to, he's reminding us to stay faithful to Jesus. And he brings some great application in verse 12. Let's look at it. It says, beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Now remember who he's talking to here. Believers. He's talking to Christians. This chapter is not written to unbelievers, but written to Christians. He says, beware. Take heed. This is strong language, but it shows us the terrible nature of unbelief. refusing to believe God, and this shows the state of your heart. See, unbelief is not an inability to understand. Unbelief is not doubting now and then. Unbelief is an unwillingness to trust God. It's an unwillingness to trust God. It's where you're hardened to the things of God and you ignore the purposes of God, and the results of a hard heart are disobedience to God, where you're unwilling to trust Him. Despite what the Bible says, despite what you've seen God do in the past, despite what you've seen God do in other people's lives. And the author of Hebrews is challenging the Hebrew believers and all of you to consider your own life. Is there a hard heart in you? One of unbelief in God or in what God can do? Perhaps you've drifted from the things of God. You don't believe God can do it, or that God wants to do it, or that God even cares about your situation. You wonder those things? Well, God does care. Perhaps you think your life is junk right now because God's trying to grow your character or mature you as a believer. Or maybe it's not going the way you planned just because of sin in your life. Or maybe it's terrible for you because people are selfish and they don't treat you as they should. Whatever the reason is, you guys, God is faithful. Jesus knows. He went through it all. God's not going to leave you. God is right there with you, offering help, just like He was with the Israelites. So Christian, don't ever go so far to depart from God and His ways. Don't drift. Don't disobey, but remain faithful to Jesus. You know, one thing I've learned over time is no matter what you're going through, you need to keep leaning into Jesus. If He seems silent, it doesn't mean He's absent from you. So don't give yourself permission to quit on Jesus. Don't give yourself permission to stop praying or reading your Bible. Don't give yourself permission to slow down going to church or being with other believers. Don't give yourself that permission, especially in hard times. You must lean into God more. And what I've read and what I've found is emotions eventually catch up to obedience. Emotions will catch up to obedience. When we lean on God, especially in tough times, our emotions, thoughts, and feelings, they can be all over the place. They can be crazy, thinking one thought, thinking the next thought, and it's completely unrelated. But they come in line with God and His purposes when we take actions in a godly way. It happened to me this week. It totally works. This works. God always likes to teach me what I'm teaching on, and this works. Well, verse 13 says, "But exhort one another daily while it's called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin." Now, I find this kind of funny. While it's called today. Well, today is always called today. Today can't be tomorrow. Today can't be yesterday. So today is today. So while you're here today, and it's still today, exhort or strongly encourage each other every day to stay close to God. And this is your responsibility, church. This is what you should be doing in your life with other believers. You are to be exhorting each other to lean into God. We're to daily exhort each other to a closer walk with God. We should be leaning into God together. We should be talking to each other about the things of God, about our times with God, being honest about our sins in the Word together. Why? Because each of us can be hardened to the things of God through the deceitfulness of sin. This verse tells us one of the ways we harden our heart towards God is through the deceitfulness of sin. See, sin deceives us. Sin looks appealing or attractive, so we go after it, and it ends up being empty. Sin deceives you. That's why you feel terrible after you've sinned, because you see it for what it's worth. It didn't satisfy. Once you've sinned, you see it was not worth it at all. Now, I have a brother. He's 2 years younger than me, and we grew up very close. We're good friends. We're close brothers, and you know what close brothers do? They fight. They argue. They look for ways to annoy each other, and they just get in each other's hair. Well, my brother David, he would always try to trick me with something. He'd always be playing practical jokes on me. And he'd usually call me while he's in another room. "Hey, Daniel, get over here quick, quick, quick." And I was hoping to come see something funny or cool or something like that. Instead, I'd come running in around the corner. He'd punch me in the stomach. Or he'd throw a tennis ball at my groin. That's what brothers do, you know? And so I'd go down in pain like, "Oh, seriously?" And he'd be laughing. "Ha, ha, ha, you totally fell for it." He totally tricked me, and I'd be feeling the pain. I'd be thinking, "Man, I'm a fool. He gets me every single time." But listen, guys, that's what sin does. It tricks you. It tricks you. It deceives you. Then you get punched, and it hurts. But this passage says we're hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Sin calls for us. We get drawn into it, and we fall for it. We're deceived by it, and we do it again and again and again and again. And over time, what happens is our hearts get hardened to the things of God because we're going after something that is not of God. So you get hardened to the things of God as you continue to believe the lie of sin. You continue to believe that your sin is small, or that it doesn't hurt anyone or anything, or that it's just once. It's not going to be a big deal. I can stop at any time. It's not going to hurt anyone. Your heart continually gets harder and harder and harder to the things of God as you continue to go after sin. Christian, beware. Do not dabble with sin. Don't entertain it. Don't go near it. If there's an area that's hitting your heart as I'm talking about sin, you know what it is. You know what sin you struggle with. It comes to your mind. You got to stay away. Start thinking of ways to avoid it instead of thinking of ways to go near it. Tell someone about it. Pray together and have that person exhort you to stay away from it. Be open. Be humble for it. Because you're God's child. He loves you. You're His. He calls you holy. He loves you despite what you've done in the past or even will do in the future. So come boldly to the throne of grace to receive God's help when you need it. Well, verse 14 says, "For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end." See, as a Christian, we're to remain faithful up until the end. Keep moving forward with Christ. It doesn't stop. Because as soon as we slow down or we stop, we start going backwards. And we're to stand strong till the end because we are partakers with Christ, meaning we share in what is Christ's. Commentary says this passage should be viewed as a sober warning, intended as a means that God uses to keep Christians resolved in their faith and obedient until the end. The ongoing experience of perseverance results in confidence and assurance that one does in fact share in Christ. This verse then provides a grave warning to everyone who claims to be saved. That is to examine yourself carefully to be sure that one is in fact a genuine believer. Because if there's no evidence of perseverance in faith and obedience, then there is real reason to doubt that such a person has ever been saved. See, I've seen sad things. I've seen professing Christians walk away from God because their hearts became hard to the things of God, and unbelief eventually sinks in over time. Christianity is not a quick emotional response. But it's a life of living to please the one that's done so much for you. It's a life lived in obedience to God because, not because you have to, but because you get to, because of what He's done for you. It's our offering to Him, because God first loved us. Well, verse 15 says, "While it is said, today, if you will hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion." The author of Hebrews reiterates the previous point. He brings it up again to drive it home, and he'll do it again in chapter 4 when we look at it next week. He says, today, if you hear His voice, today, you guys, you need to listen to God. Don't harden your hearts like the Israelites did when they rebelled. It's not just trying harder and doing better as a Christian, checking things off the box, but it's a deeper relationship with Jesus. And out of that deeper relationship will come a desire to live for Christ, to apply the Bible to your life. This is where this comes from. Faithfulness to Jesus comes from a close relationship with Jesus. Well, verse 16 to 19, this is the, we'll wrap up here. "For who, having heard, rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief." Well, sadly, the author tells us of the Israelites that died in the wilderness before entering the promised land because of simple unbelief. And he asks some questions. Who rebelled? Who was angry with? Who was God angry with? Who didn't get to enter into His rest? It was those who weren't faithful to God. They didn't trust Him. And the writer of Hebrews is making a strong point to close this chapter. Don't be like these people who weren't faithful. There were strong consequences for their unbelief and disobedience. They didn't get to enter God's rest. And His rest will be discussed next week as we go through chapter 4. But the key to entering His rest was belief. You can see it at the last verse there. Trusting in God. The Israelites didn't believe, so they didn't get to enter the rest of the promised land. See, the primary issue or the focus of our concern as believers should be this. Is my heart open to God? Am I eager to learn what God wants me to learn? Am I willing to do what God wants me to do? And church, we need to be leaning into God. If you're not, you're going to slowly drift from the things of God, like Pastor Joel warned us a couple weeks ago. And you slowly drift from the things of God. You find your heart slowly hardening to the things of God, and you'll find yourself in disobedience to God. And every time we disobey God, it's rooted in unbelief. We think things like that sin I'm pursuing is better than God. It's more pleasurable than God. Or this lifestyle I'm working so hard to achieve will be more satisfying than God. These are lies. These are all lies. Christian, faithfulness to God is your purpose. And as you fulfill that purpose over the course of your life, you see that it's the most satisfying way to live. There's no better way to live. Your purpose is to stay on course with God. We read in staff this week, Carol mentioned this verse, Micah 6, verse 8. It says, He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Christian, will the years of your life see you as faithful, trusting, committed follower of Jesus, taking steps of faith? Or will the years of your life be filled with slow drift from the things of God and you become unfaithful to Jesus? It's your choice how you live. It's your life. But I know from reading the Bible, I know from personal experience that God wants us to continue trusting Him, to be faithful to Him, because He's always been faithful to us. He's right there to help us in our time of need. He won't leave you no matter what you've done, no matter the sin or how previously you've rejected God. God is always there for you.